Okay, let's start. Just quickly back to this problem, Tay problem. You should not confuse the complexity of the proof with complexity of the algorithm, right? Here, the algorithm simply says, sort them in decreasing order of probability over length. So, and this is the order in which you put files. So what is the complexity? And log n, because this is the time needed to sort. But notice the complexity of the proof, which is irrelevant for the complexity of the algorithm. The proof appears to be quadratic because we bubble sort it. But that's just the proof that greedy did succeed in finding optimal solution. It's not the complexity of the algorithm, right? So the fact that we are bubble sorting here to remove all of the inversions from this supposedly better solution will be quadratic, but that's just complexity of this alleged to verify that in fact there can be no better solution than what greedy does, because with this method of bubble sorting, it always drops the expected time, so we get an inconsistency at the end. So make sure you don't confuse, you know, what justification has no impact on the complexity of the algorithm. Okay, let's see this one. So now you are given n array, sorted arrays of different length. And you want to merge them. Merging is not done in place, right? If you have two arrays, you merge them by moving elements of both arrays into a new array that is big enough to hold both pieces. So now assume that you have a whole bunch of sorted arrays, and you want to merge them in a way that will minimize the number of moves of the elements while you are merging. So for example, if you first merge these two, and then say you merge the result with this one, and then say you merge these two and merge the result of this to get to the end, you see this point was moved. All the points here are moved once, then here they're moved once again two, and here they're moved three times. However, points here are moved only once, twice, right? So how many moves you will make depends on how you do the merging. So your goal is to merge them by using minimal number of moves. How would you do that? So merging operation involves, you have two arrays, say this array and that array, and you produce a larger array by moving, say this is the smallest element of the two, goes here, this is, say the next one will be here, and then whatever, sorry, so it should go from this end, if it's smallest, and then say maybe this one is the smallest, and so forth. You have to move, when you merge, you move elements into a new array, right? That's one move, yeah. So each element will be moved once from either of the two arrays into the new array. Yeah? And you have to minimize the total number of elements that have been moved. How would you do that? Yes.
Is that some kind of how you merge, when you always change the same number of merges, so you just do a crazy algorithm on merging the smallest two remaining?
So, sorry, you are saying that it doesn't matter in what order you merge them. That's right, you start with the smallest tool, yes. So you are actually moving elements of several arrays simultaneously. Okay. But you have to move each time. You have to move when you have two arrays to produce the third array. You have to move all elements of both arrays.
But you're moving. You're only taking one element at a time.
Yes. Yes, so for each, of course, the number of moves, when you do any two arrays, the number of moves is precisely the sum of the number of elements of these two arrays, right? But it matters in what order you move it. Now, for example, this array, should you put very short one or very long one here? Long one, because these will be moved only twice if you do it in this order. So the way to do it, you take two shortest arrays, and you merge them. Then you take the next, then among these newly, so one new array, you delete these two. Now you again look for the two shortest arrays, you merge them, and you delete these two and keep only the result, and you keep doing that with the idea being if you start with, so the elements that get merged first will be moved more often than the elements. In fact, the number of merges each element has will be equal to the depth in the corresponding tree, right? So if you merge first the shortest elements, sorry, the shortest arrays, then on the deepest, with the largest depth, will be the smallest arrays. So consequently, this will minimize the number of moves. You still need the same number of merges, because each merge reduces two arrays into a single one. But you don't get the same number of moves of elements. Because you see, for example, so let's assume that we did it exactly in this way. We merged these two into this, then we merged this and that to produce this array, then say we merged these two together, and finally we merged the result with these two. Now you see this one, these elements have been moved once, twice, three times. But this element is moved once, twice, right? So you should start by merging the shortest ones, because those that you start with are those that will end up on the largest depth, right? So the total number of moves will be minimized if the deepest, the longest branch to the tree ends with a leaf that is as short as possible. Does this remind you of another famous algorithm? Huffman codes, exactly. So I suggest we skip a few and move to the Huffman codes because, and then we will go back to other algorithms. Here it is. So, guys. So this is really, really an important and famous algorithm. And you will see the solution is not terribly hard, but it has, guys, a little bit quieter, please, no talking. So this is the problem, and I'll explain to you why it's, it's important because it's really used for data compression. It's one of the possible algorithms to use to compress data, but there is more to it. So this is what you need. So assume that you have English sentences and you want to encode them. Well, one way to do it, which is how ASCII does it, say, let's see, English has how many, 26 letters, you need space between words and you need a few for punctuation marks and assume, let's ignore the capitals. So let's just take 26 symbols, one space and five punctuation marks like question mark and exclamation and dot and full stop and whatever. So say 32. How many bits do I need to encode 32 symbols with different bytes? I need 5 bits because 2 to the fifth is 32, right? So one way to do it would be take for each letter, assign it a binary string, and you do the same for the space and for the punctuation marks. And then when you have a bit stream, you know precisely how to slice into groups of 5 and then use a lookup table to decode the text. Now, this is not a good way of encoding text because all of the symbols have the same length. Why do you think that's bad? Exactly. So some letters like A, I, T, I think P, and whichever are used extremely frequently, but say W, X, and Y are used much, much less frequently for an order of magnitude. But you are using the same number of bits for all the letters. So obviously, this is inefficient, right? Because you need 5 bits per letter. So the point is, can we do it more efficiently? It will be more efficient if frequently used symbols get short strings and less frequently used symbols then can get longer strings. But what do you think now when I have a bit stream, what is now a difficult part? That you don't know how to cut it exactly. So if the strings can be of different length, then if you have a bit stream, you don't know whether this, you should take 3 bits here because that's one symbol, or you should take these 5 bits here that might be another symbol. What do you think, what do the codes, what do they have to satisfy so that such ambiguity never occurs? Look, Something like that shouldn't occur. So what it should not occur? When does the ambiguity occur? If one code has an initial segment, a prefix, that is equal to another code. Are you with me? So you cannot say, for example, if I had 0, 1, 0 as 1, say this denotes letter A, and I have 1, 0, 0 denotes B, then if I find a sequence that looks like this, 1, 0, 0, zero, say 1, 0, 0, I don't know whether this is A followed by a B, or this is a B followed, say, if 1, 0, 0 is C. So I can read it in two ways. I can read it like this, and this becomes A, and this is B. Or the very same string, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, can be also read as this being B, and this being C. So you see, it's ambiguous. What's the reason for this ambiguity? It's precisely this, that the code for A is an initial segment, a prefix of the code for B. So prefix codes are those that have the property that no code of a symbol is a prefix of a code of another symbol, right? If this is the case, this ambiguity cannot happen. We simply move to the right until we hit first time a code of one symbol. We know that we have to cut here, because if we go further down, we cannot get a code for another letter, because no code has an initial segment that is also a code. Right? Okay, so these type of codes are called prefix codes. How do we produce prefix codes? There is a very simple canonical way, namely, you take any binary tree, okay, say this tree. Say this tree, okay? And whenever we go to the left, we call this 1. Whenever we go to the right, we call this 0. And now assign the symbols to the leaves only, right? So what would be the code for A? The code for A, tell me, what's the code for A? You go from the root down. So it will be just A is equal 1, 1, 1, 1. Oops, sorry, there are only three of them. OK, so what is the code for D? Well, it's 1, 0, 0. So D is 1, 0, 0. What is the code for E? The code for E is 0, 1. Right? Now notice, the codes are of different length. But because they are branches of the tree, when would I have a code to be initial segment of another code? Only if an inner node was assigned a letter. For as long as I assigned letters only to the leaves, okay, I am fine, there can be no ambiguity. Now the point, the problem that we have to solve is the following. Assume that you are given the frequencies of each symbol. How would you do that? Well, you take any book, you know, you run it through a simply a program that counts number of occurrences of each letter. Maybe you do this with a couple of books, and lo and behold, the values, the fractions of each letter in terms of the total number of symbols will give you approximate frequency of that letter in English language. So what do you think? What is this frequency useful for? Say if you want to communicate in a secret way and you devise a very simple cryptographic scheme in which you simply permute the letters. How would you decode such a cryptographic message? You just compute the frequency of each letter, and lo and behold, it will be close to the average frequencies in English. So this is an important magnitude. Now, given the frequencies of each symbol, the task is to find a code so that the expected length of a message of, say, n symbols is as short as possible. So what does this mean? It means that frequent letters should have short codes, and less frequent letters should have longer codes, will be deeper in the tree. Now we come to really an amazing fact, okay? This problem was attempted by two famous people, namely Claude Shannon and Fano, I forget what his first name is. And they couldn't solve it. They came up with a suboptimal solution that performed well in practice, but they knew it wasn't optimal. What they did was the following. They used divide and conquer strategy. They split split all the symbols in two parts so that probability of each part was as close to 1/2 as possible, right? So they split all the symbols into two subsets such that probability, joint probability of all letters here was as close to 1/2 as possible. Automatically, this is also, maybe this one will be slightly larger than 1/2. This will be slightly smaller than 1/2. And then they proceeded in this way, splitting this so that the joint probabilities are as close to equally split as possible. And this produces a rather pretty good schema because, you see, you will soon come to the point when 1/2 of what is left will be just the probability of a single symbol, right? Because the probability of a single symbol is large. So it will terminate there, but the other side will keep branching. But they knew, by counterexample, that this was not optimal. Now, the interesting fact, of course, they tried pretty hard because that's an extremely important problem for compressing files. They tried pretty hard to solve it, but they couldn't. And the shocking part is because Claude Shannon was a really, really a genius. He has made extraordinary contribution to theory of communications. There is a famous Shannon sampling formula, then capacity of the noisy channel, Shannon capacity, and so forth. But they failed on this one. As they were trying to solve the problem, Fano was actually teaching, I think, at Stanford. And a young kid was taking the class, and his name was what? Huffman, right? So Huffman actually managed to produce optimal code. And you will see the construction is actually, I guess, once you figure out how to think about the problem, the construction is actually rather simple and natural. But so what I want to tell you is that greed is obviously then capable of solving tough problems. So it's a pretty powerful technique, because if Shannon couldn't get it, it definitely is not trivial. So let's see what Huffman did. Huffman turned the whole problem upside down. Notice that Shannon Fano solution is top to bottom solution, right? Because you split the two sets, the set into two subsets, so you kind of decide the big picture where goes where, and then you keep going down towards the leaves. And of course, the most frequent symbols will be decided first, and the least frequent symbols will be decided last. Huffman simply did it bottom up. So let's see how he did it. So assume that this is the tree that corresponds to the optimal solution, right? You look at the longest branch to this tree, right? The claim is whatever is optimal solution, there is one such that here on the deepest depth, there can be several of them, but say we pick one deepest, you put the least frequent element. Why can we do that? What do you think? Well, clearly, if the least frequent element was somewhere else, if you swap these two guys, then this having smaller probability will go on the larger depth, so the expected search time will drop, right? Because here it is, the length is only 2, right? So if you move, if you take the least frequent element from here and put it here and move this element here, you can only get a better code or equal code. So he figured out the least frequent element had to be on the longest branch. Now, let's look at the parent, right? Clearly, the parent has to have another children, because if you have something like this, you can remove this and move this element here. So every node has to have 2 children. Now, the claim is, you see, this guy, the other child, must be also a leaf. Why? Well, if it wasn't the leaf, this guy wouldn't be at the deepest possible depth, right? If this had, if it wasn't a leaf, the depth of this guy would be larger than the depth of this guy. But then by the same argument, on the other leaf, you can place the second least, the least frequent symbol. So in the, if there is an optimal, whatever is an optimal prefix code, there is always an optimal one in which the first and the second least frequent element are the leaves of the branches of maximal depth. Good. So now, what he did, this fact we will use to prove the optimality. What Huffman did was, well, if these two guys are the least frequent elements, we can replace them by one new symbol and remove them from the tree. So if this is A, this is B, we invent a new symbol called AB. And we put that probability of AB is precisely probability of A plus probability of B. If we get optimal prefix code for this system that has one element less, it's clear how to design a prefix code for the original problem, because all what you have to do is remove the symbol AB and place the two symbols underneath, right? So what Kaufman did was simply the following. You take the two least likely symbols, you delete them and replace them with their parent node and a new symbol AB with frequency P of A plus P of B. And now continue doing that until you get to the root. So it's exactly what we did with this merging business. We took two shortest arrays, merged them together, removed the arrays, and consider this array that is of the size sum of the lengths. And then again, of this new system, we pick two that are the shortest and merge them together again. So this is guaranteed to produce codes, prefix codes that are optimal. Why is this so? The proof is very simple, and it's by induction, right? So you assume that there is a better code. By what we have shown, if there is a better code, there is one that places the least frequent and the next second least frequent element on the branches on the longest branches. If you remove both from Huffman code and this new code, you will get inductively a smaller prefix code. And by inductive hypothesis, this code produced by Huffman must be optimal. Thus, when you don't do the surgery, the result will be also optimal, because both codes are affected in the very same way for the same magnitude. So it's really simple. Okay, this is non-trivial. Please, okay, I know the book is expensive. Get it from the library or whatever, pirate it or whatever you do. It's up to you and your consciousness, and you're possibly going to jail. I don't want to be this, cricket that persuaded Pinocchio to go with the fox, was it? Anyhow, so read the book, because the book is absolutely wonderfully written, unlike Corman that is dry and just, if you forgive me, anal retentive, just horrendous. Kleinberg and Tardosz is really written So whenever we cover a piece of material and everything is there, including FFT and convolution and divide and conquer, please read it carefully, because this is explained in a wonderful way and in a great. And also, besides the problems that we do in class, you can find lots of solved exercises to prepare for the midterm. And moreover, there are also unsolved problems that you can attack to practice. Okay, so any questions about Huffman code? So it's very simple. You find two symbols with the smallest frequency, you merge them. That will be your last branch of the tree. You replace them with a new symbol, and again, among these symbols, find two of the smallest frequency, merge them, replace them with another symbol with the probabilities that are sum of the two probabilities, and keep doing that until you get to the root. This is kind of, okay, so this is non-trivial, because guess what? If it were trivial, Shannon would have seen it. But lo and behold, to his embarrassment, it was only Huffman, who was just a kid, a naive kid like yourselves. So we go back. This was a good, it was a better order to prove. Okay, let's do another one. So here is the problem. So you have a very long road, okay, somewhere in rural Australia, right? And the houses are kind of pretty sparse, right? Then you have a long stretch and no houses, and again, and then a lonely house here, and two houses here, and so forth. But Uncle Malcolm Turnbull wants to be friendly and supportive of all Australians, including the rural ones, right? So he mandates that Telstra has to put cellular towers along the way to cover all the houses, no matter how sparse they are. So you are given, you know that the range of each tower is 5 kilometers. The radius, yeah, the radius. So 5 kilometers around the tower, you cover all the houses that are inside. You have to do the job. You are a Telstra engineer, and you want to put as few towers as possible to minimize the cost, right, to cover all of the houses. How would you do that? Now, somewhere the houses are clustered, somewhere the houses are more. What is tempting to do, again, where to put a tower?
You go half the house, so that the station is 5 kilometers.
Okay, so that's the correct solution, but you let the rabbit out too quickly. So how about this brilliant solution? You look where the houses are densest, and you put a tower precisely smack there. Well, show that this might result in a suboptimal solution. Now it's your turn. So what do you do?
You find the first uncovered house.
Yep.
Then you go 5 kilometers faster.
Exactly. So say this is west, this is east. You take the first house that has to be covered, you go 5 kilometers far, you put a tower. Then you take care of, see all the houses that you took care of, find first uncovered house, go 5 kilometers to the right, put a tower there. Why? Because in this way, you cover this house, but you are trying to cover as many houses as possible. Now, why is this optimal? Well, assume that there is a better solution, and we show that this really can be, right? How? Assume that first tower was closer than 5 kilometers. And all the towers did cover correctly. What can you do to mold this solution, to massage it into a greedy one? Exactly, just move it to the right 5 kilometers. You don't lose anything because everything on the left will be covered. And whatever this guy was covering, this guy might cover even more. So this shows, again, by cut and paste, that's optimal solution. OK, now here is an interesting problem. That you are the Telstra engineer, right? But you have a junior associate. And he tells you that he figured out if he starts from this end and goes this way, he will need fewer towers. The question is there a configuration of houses when this can happen? What do you think? Now, this problem is an example when greedy strategy can be used to derive useful information about the objects constructed. Is this possible? You see, if you do greedy from the left, how many towers will you put? You will put the minimal number of towers that can cover, whatever that number is. This doesn't say how the towers are placed, but it will be the fewest possible number of towers. If you do greedy from the right, how many towers are you going to put? Also, minimal possible number of towers among all placements, regardless how they are obtained, greedy or not greedy, right? So both greedy from the left and greedy from the right must come up with the same solution, which is precisely, maybe there will be different placement, but the number of towers must be the same because both are minimal possible numbers of towers among all possible configuration, no matter how designed, that cover everything. So this guarantees you that both will be the same. Okay, that's enough for the day. On Friday, we continue. Please. Try to solve the rest of the problems by yourself so that you can appreciate more when we do them here.